up more about this topic. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Vigo. Mr. Bowden, your turn.
Thank you very much, Professor Vigo, for situating the interdisciplinary issues so clearly. What I want to do now is focus on one particular aspect of our report in more concrete terms. And it might be helpful if we think about the categories of discipline that we've considered. We've had a very good discussion on cybercrime. We're not here to discuss, of course, the content of the cybersecurity package. We're here to discuss the report we provided to Parliament. But of course, in questions, we'd be delighted to take questions about the cybersecurity package in relation to our work. But we've been discussing cybercrime. We have touched on, as Professor Bigo has mentioned, questions of national security, which is a delicate matter. But there is a third area which I want to now address, which is the question of foreign intelligence gathering by third countries. And I think we should take a step back and appreciate that, of course, questions of national security are the purview of member states. We all understand this is a fact of the treaty. But it is perfectly legitimate for European institutions, Parliament, data protection authorities, to consider the problem of protection of European citizens' rights from the surveillance activities of third countries, which would be illegal under European law. And this is what I now want to move into. If we could have the... I think we've missed a slide. If we could just go back one, please. So this picture on the left, you can see a modern data center. And on the right, you can see a photograph of a room which was built in a telecommunications switching center in San Francisco in 2003. And my talk can really be boiled down to the question of, does there exist a room like on the right in a data center like on the left? When we think of cloud computing, of course, when it's referred to in the popular media, we think about a place to store our photographs and emails as consumers. But in fact, the business and e-government agenda for cloud computing is perhaps more significant, because until very recently, if governments or businesses wanted to process the personal data of European citizens, they would do so using software and equipment located within European territory. But the question that the business or industrial use of cloud computing raises is, we may potentially be looking at the migration of all European data into clouds for processing, not for storage. The great advantage of cloud computing for processing is that you can harness the power of thousands of computers at once to work on a problem in parallel. And this is a far more significant agenda than the mere use of cloud for remote data storage. If we could have the next slide, please. So I have to go back and give some history about one particular country. I cannot really discuss what I'm going to discuss without referring extensively to the United States, because the fact is that the United States has the overwhelmingly dominant industrial capacity in both software and hardware for cloud computing. Back in 2003, as I mentioned, an internet technician working in AT&T San Francisco discovered that there was a secret room being built in his switching center which contained essentially a split in the fiber optic cables carrying the main internet traffic on the western seaboard of the United States. And the diverted traffic was being scanned by a state-of-the-art deep packet inspection box, which was examining the full flow of traffic on that fiber optic cable and diverting some part of it, after analysis, to the US National Security Agency. Now, this story didn't break until 2005 in the New York Times, and then several other whistleblowers emerged from both the FBI and also the National Security Agency. And they tried to get a political and media attention for what they believed was surveillance which was being illegally conducted on United States citizens. In 2007, because of the public controversy, these activities were legalized by something called the Protect America Act. And it essentially legalized a new paradigm, which was to collect potentially everything and then analyze it later. And in particular, under United States law, there are special protections for United States citizens, which I will discuss. So all of the controversy around this time was purely about the rights of United States citizens and residents. There was no discussion on the impact of foreign persons. If you could have the next slide, please. So in 2008, just before the election of President Obama, on a bipartisan basis, these issues were politically resolved with the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Amendment Act, the FISA Amendment Act. It in fact amends legislation first passed in 1978. And in particular, I'm going to discuss Section 1881A. It provides for collection of foreign intelligence information, which I'll come on to. It intentionally targets only essentially the rest of the world, only non-US persons who are outside the United States borders. It gives a blanket authorization for up to 1 year. It requires the minimization of access of data about US citizens after the fact of collection. And it provides that all of this must be done in complete secrecy with various penalties. And it also says that this must be done consistent with the United States Constitution Fourth Amendment, which is the one that protects privacy. However, if we can have the next slide, please. First of all, we need to give a close parsing of what is meant by foreign intelligence information. And it's a lot broader than you think. I've included the clauses here. It includes things like sabotage and terrorism and serious crime, as you would expect. However, it does include also information with respect to a foreign-based political organization or merely a foreign territory that relates to the conduct of the foreign affairs of the United States. So that is obviously an incredibly broad definition. And if one makes a direct comparison between the national security laws of European Union member states, one does not find anything like this completely broad mandate for purely political surveillance. The next slide, please. So to summarize, Section 81A of FISA combined three elements for the first time. They had been there in separate pieces of legislation, but they were first, for the first time, combined in 2008. One, the targeting essentially of the rest of the world's data, only non-US persons located outside the US. Second, it applied to what it called remote computing services. And this was new. This means it applies to cloud computing. This means rather than simply tapping telecommunication companies like AT&T, this means that the big cloud providers like Microsoft and Google can be instructed to comply with this order. So the consequence of this is that if encryption is used to protect your data going from your browser, the little padlock symbol, to the cloud, in fact, that is no protection at all, because this gives an authority to go inside the data center once the encryption is removed for data processing. And this is why the real agenda is not cloud as data storage, but cloud as massively parallel processing as a commodity. And thirdly, there's this element that it's nothing to do necessarily with criminality or even with properly defined national security. It can be purely political surveillance to further the foreign policy interests of a third country. Next slide, please. So you may remember when I quoted Section 81A, there was this perhaps reassuring stipulation that this had to be done in a manner consistent with the Fourth Amendment. And some of you may have seen policy material from the United States mission to the EU. I would ask you to go back and scrutinize that material because none of the material from the United States government has mentioned anything I've said at all so far. There has been a complete silence in the time that FISA 1881A has been discussed for perhaps the past 18 months, a complete silence from the United States government on these matters. So it has emerged, and I give the details here, in dribs and drabs over the past few years, that in fact the Fourth Amendment offers no protection to non-US persons outside the US. So to emphasize, what this means is that any European Union citizen's personal data put into a cloud subject to US jurisdiction can be subject to mass surveillance for purely political purposes. Next slide, please. This point I won't discuss in too much detail, but what this slide is about is to say that if you consider the technical foundation of cloud computing for parallel processing, in fact, there is going to be an incentive for those governments that want to be able to conduct systematic surveillance of cloud computing. They are going to have to go and approach Google and Microsoft to actually build in the surveillance in Microsoft and Google's software, the fabric operating system that actually controls cloud computing. It's going to be necessary to build in this mass surveillance capacity into the cloud. I haven't quite got time to develop that argument today, but please ask me a question about it. The next slide. And this slide here is really to make the point that we're not really talking about requests for data. We're not talking, as indeed data protection authorities seem to believe, or perhaps when discussion of the Patriot Act is cropped up, we're not talking about trying to devise some sort of legal instrument to specify access to a block of data, request it, and then get it back. This is a state of continuous mass surveillance conducted all the time on the entirety of flows of data. And the diagram you can see here was in fact prepared by the American Civil Liberties Union back in 2006, trying to map the known access points similar to the one I described in San Francisco. There wasn't just one, it was a systematic series of installations throughout the fabric of the United States infrastructure. The next slide, please. So I have perhaps rather rashly described this as we have a danger here of what I would call a Maginot line in cyberspace. Members of this parliament have, of course, negotiated in great detail safeguards over such matters as SWIFT and PNR. But you will understand from what I've said that the risk is that those agreements could in fact be bypassed and direct mass surveillance could be conducted to the extent that any of this data is put into clouds. Now, Article 29 and data protection authorities do not really seem to have been aware of the situation up until 18 months ago. I've briefed some of them privately about this situation over this time, and in June last year, Article 29 did publish its opinion on cloud computing. They do, although largely ignoring the problem still, have one paragraph about this. They talk about access for national security and law enforcement, and they say it is of the utmost importance to ensure that mutual legal assistance treaties are the exclusive means used for a foreign government or third country to access data for this kind. However, the solution they offer, I'm afraid, is open to criticism. I don't have time, again, to say why precisely this doesn't work, but essentially the legal solution that they offer is in fact no solution whatsoever. Next slide, please. More concerning, perhaps, is we have in the package for data protection the invention of a concept called binding corporate rules for data processes. Now, again, this is more explained in the report, and I don't have time to explain it here, but essentially this is a legal mechanism which has been specially devised between data protection authorities and the industry over the past 4 years to legitimate flows of EU personal data into clouds. And disturbingly, we find when we look at Article 29's formulation of this, next slide please, that, if you like, loopholes have already been built in. When you look at the small print of what Article 29 has said about the conditions to make BCRs for processes acceptable, they foresee and allow the application of laws such as FISAR and indeed the Patriot Act. This is not going to be prevented by the data protection reform package as is currently formulated. We need a complete change of direction. Next slide, please. So we might also think that this could be taken care of by the so-called umbrella discussions in the area of law enforcement between the EU and the US. There's an excerpt here from a non-paper about the state of negotiations from 2011. And it is a bottom line for the US that this umbrella agreement shall not cover transfers from private parties to private parties, which would be the situation for the cloud. So we're not going to get a resolution of this from the umbrella agreement as things stand. Next slide, please. So to summarize the points, we have really a situation where cloud valence, to coin a phrase, is potentially about all EU data. Now, of course, this parliament did investigate the Echelon affair 12 years ago. But the Echelon was merely about communication surveillance. This is potentially about surveillance of all EU data that could be put into cloud computing. Encryption is futile, as I've tried to explain, for data that is processed in the cloud, because the cloud computing power can only process data which is decryptable by the cloud provider. Of course, if you're just talking about cloud storage, you can encrypt the data yourself. But mostly, that is not applicable. And surveillance by a foreign government, by a third country, raises very different questions than surveillance by European governments, partly because we do not have the application of fundamental rights. The unpalatable truth is that mass surveillance over political data, or for political purposes of European personal data, has been lawful under United States law since 2008. And the extraordinary thing is, nobody noticed for 4 years. The European Commission didn't notice, data protection authorities did not analyze this legislation, nobody noticed. It is astonishing. And further, we find that in the formulation of the data protection regulation, the loopholes provided to allow this have already been built in by the data protection authorities we expect to protect us. Now, our report has achieved a little bit of media attention over the past month or 5 weeks, and if you follow the Twitter streams on the newspaper reports which have emerged, which have been accurate, they have not been sensationalized, European public opinion is horrified. They simply cannot understand how our data protection machinery can have got to the stage where this has been overlooked or indeed set up to be allowed. So apologies for slightly going over my time, but I hope that's given an introduction to discuss. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you both, Professor Bigot, Mr. Bowden. And we still have some minutes to go. Let's make good use of them. Some floor for discussion? Any member willing to make a point, specific questions? Please, Mrs. Argentini.
Yeah, yes, of course.
Mrs. Intveld.
Yes, thank you, Chair. I'll just comment on the second presentation, because I think the first one largely concurred with the remarks I made earlier in the cybersecurity. We very much agree, and I'm very pleased that Mr. Bowden has raised this issue, because, as you know, I think the first time I submitted a parliamentary question about FISA was back in 2007. Or maybe even before, and I'm like you. I'm actually appalled that nobody has reacted to this. I wonder if we would be as complacent if this wasn't the United States, but if it were China. And I'm pretty sure that, you know, they probably don't even need legislation to do the exact same thing. And as there are more companies setting up businesses there, they have the same capacity. And I'm sure there are other countries that would be interested in doing this. I would like to stress that this is not a technical problem. The cloud has merely made it worse, but it's a legal problem. It's a problem of jurisdiction, because even if this were about good old-fashioned paper archives, data stored in paper archives, the problem would still be the same, namely a third country, in this case the United States, that considers that data that are collected and stored on European territory still fall within their jurisdiction because of their own definition of jurisdiction. Now, okay, we can complain about the United States or about China or Russia or any other country that's doing this, but the real problem, of course, is within Europe. We have brought this to the attention of the European Commission countless times. As I said, I put in questions in 2007. Even before that, we raised it. The European Commission so far has remained silent, turning a blind eye, probably because they're timid in the confrontation with the Americans, or they just don't know how to handle it. The European Commission claims that the problem will be solved when the new regulation enters into force. It will not. It will not solve the problem. The real problem is that the European Commission, and indeed the European governments, do not stand up for the interests of European citizens. The Patriot Act, in the wider sense, we've raised this with the Dutch government, and maybe the question has been raised in other countries as well. Because of the Patriot Act that FISA is a part of, the company that is producing Dutch passports that include fingerprints from Dutch citizens can... Well, this is like gaslight. those data are accessible to the US authorities freely, without limit. Now we're going to set up a system of medical records. that will be managed by a company which, unsurprisingly, also has a presence on U.S. territory and therefore also falls under the Patriot Act. And I'm very happy that your report got so much publicity, because I hope that somebody in the European Commission is finally going to take this seriously and respond to the issues, because they have to. They can no longer remain silent, and I'm very pleased that you gave them so much material and obliged them to answer.
Thank you. Now, Mrs. Sargentini.
Thank you, Chair. A question, because I'll come back later on the cloud computing and what we're going to do next. Mr. Bowden, you made the point, and I've heard you made that point before, that the Data Protection Directive does not fill the gaps that need to be filled to secure our data. Could you be more precise, please? The deadline for amendments is coming pretty soon now.
And Señora Romero.
Sí. Gracias, Presidente. Yo también estoy, como mis colegas, bastante asombrada de la explicación.
Like my colleagues, I'm quite scared when I hear the explanation this morning. Every time that we've heard people speak about cloud computing, it sounds like a taboo. Nobody knows what it is, where that data comes from. So I think it's actually quite simple. After having heard the explanation this afternoon, it seems that here in Europe there hasn't been any interest to go more in depth in this particular subject. All afternoon we've been talking about cybercrime, but we haven't spoken about the rights of citizens in cases where citizens do consent to their data being used. It's a much deeper problem. It's not only about cybercrime, which of course can use that technology, but we're actually talking about something that's much broader than that. As was said, the committee has forgotten all about that. We have a package on data protection that's got nothing to do with cloud computing. So why are we talking about a directive that doesn't include cloud computing? If our files are sent off to who knows what country because there are data collecting bodies there, well, today we've heard that some of those centers can be in places like the United States. And then when it comes to international law, the committee must deal with the issue. It may not have looked at mutual assistance, but in the package on privacy, we must talk about cloud computing. So what needs to be done is to understand what is the priority in terms of cloud computing, because we're talking about creating bodies that are in charge of data protection, but how can we do that if we're giving third countries, without any type of safeguards, all of this information? There are some important questions that need to be addressed for data protection, and I would appreciate it if you could give me this information. Thank you very much for the report.
And if I not seeing any further hands being raised from the floor, if not, we turn back to the podium. First floor goes to Professor Bigo. Would you, or maybe Mr.
Yeah.
Bowden, you
yes.
would like to go first? Then you go.
Thank you very much for those questions. firstly, just to, of course, I want to pay tribute to Sophie and Develt's work in this area, because she, I think, has been working on this issue, to my knowledge, longer than any other MEP. Just one minor point is what I've discussed today, the Pfizer Amendment Act, is in fact nothing to do with the Patriot Act. The powers under the Patriot Act are an entirely separate question and a matter of great concern also. What I've tried to bring out in this report and through other channels is that, in fact, the Pfizer Amendment Act has been not only totally overlooked, but if you are not a US citizen, it is worse for you than the Patriot Act. and this is a critical point, which again I refer you to the report to go into more deeply, to the question of the deadline for amendments and what do we do about this. Well, on page 48 of the report, we do make some preliminary recommendations, and I'll just summarize those for you briefly. The first is that we should disapply the existing derogations allowing transfer of data outside the EU for cloud computing platforms. In other words, it isn't just a problem for binding corporate rules, for processors, the new mechanism. It's also a problem for model contracts. It's also a problem for safe harbor. Any transfers that occur under the existing derogations give no protection against political mass surveillance under FISA. And data protection authorities know this. Many data protection authorities have not been happy about safe harbor, but I think the aspect that FISA in particular applies to cloud computing has really only emerged in the past year. And from what I've said, I hope to be clear that it's the particular applicability of FISA to cloud computing that really has to be a very grave concern. Another recommendation we make is that we do need much more intensive and immediate academic study of this. It is astonishing that there are so few scholars in Europe who actually have read and analyzed the situation, not just with US legislation, but with other third country legislation. There are other third countries, obviously, who are already or will be very important in cloud computing. There has been no parallel analysis or even complete US analysis. I can name you on my, one hand, the scholars who are active in this area. So it is really just almost by serendipitous good fortune that we're able to make this presentation to you today, because probably the agenda that was expected on our report of protecting privacy and cybercrime is not the one I presented to you today. I think the third recommendation we would make is, at the very least, there should be prominent warnings to European citizens that when they put their data into cloud within range of particularly one country's jurisdiction, they are at risk of having their political activities surveilled for no reason, for no criminal reason, for no reason that is justifiable in European law. Now, in fact, this is not my recommendation. One of the best, in fact, probably the best data protection authority in all of the European Union is the regional authority of Schleswig-Holstein in Germany, the Independent Center for Privacy Protection. They have also been alert to these issues, and they have also recommended that European Union citizens receive prominent warnings about this kind of surveillance before they put data into the cloud. And the final recommendation we make is that, unfortunately, as Sophie in 't Veld has already mentioned, there is no legal defense against this. There is no legal or, in fact, technical guarantee one can give against the kind of mass surveillance apparatus that you saw in the AT&T switching center. It can be done in secret under the national security laws of another country. There is not the remotest possibility that, say, an auditor, a security audit company, ticking boxes on some security assessment is going to be able to uncover whether that sort of secret surveillance is taking place, particularly in United States territory. The only alternative is to provide a large industrial capacity for cloud computing solely under European jurisdiction. So we make the recommendation that there should be a development of a European industrial policy for cloud computing, not just the hardware, but it's very important we consider the software, and that software, in my opinion, should be open source and free software. And we suggested a target of perhaps 50% of public sector computing should be done in the cloud by 2020. That is in line with other goals that have been set in terms of European Union IT policy in the past. But I'm afraid I just have to come back to the point that it is astonishing to me that this agenda appears to have been entirely neglected in the Commission policy-making process and also by data protection authorities.
Thank you. Mr. Bowden, now you're Professor Pico.
One point also, because we are on the interstate relation, but we need also to be very aware that European citizens may have no choice if, for example, their company go on the cloud and ask them to go. So it's very important not only that the individual as such receive warning, but that the companies which are doing that for better management, profits, and so on, understand what they are doing. because they don't understand better than the European citizen. And that's also something which is really important in terms of companies.